All right. Well, I want to be the first and possibly the last to welcome everybody to the American Institute of Philosophical and Cultural Thought, otherwise known as Redbud Hill, when concerts are occurring here. I have to get a new set of signs made to put in the alley. I decided not to put the Redbud Hill signs out in the alley because I was afraid it would confuse people. But in any case, I think this will continue to be Redbud Hill as well as the American Institute of Philosophical and Cultural Thought. My extremely pleasant job for the evening, apart from co-hosting you with the dear wife, is only to thank a few people and then to introduce the president of the Institute. Among the people who have to be thanked, top on that list is my wife, Gay.
All right.
Who is John is going to tell you the story of the Institute, but as Candace observed a few minutes ago, so your house is an institute, she says to Gay. Yeah, the way that happened was, dear, let's turn the house into an institute. And she said, okay. After which, she has been avidly, in fact, even whip-crackingly, behind the process of creating the inventories of the books. The task is going to be endless. This is going to go on for the rest of our lives. But that's all right, because we don't have anything else to do. Maybe we have a few other things to do. But, I mean, what's the point in throwing oneself into the artistic project that is this house and not figuring out some way to share? I also have to thank her very much for being willing to put up with living in a hotel, which is a hotel which has been gradually transformed into an art gallery and library. Still, it was always my dream, I have to admit, to live in the midst of art and books and the kind of beauty that those bring into a person's life. I think that the secret of being creative has something to do with surrounding oneself with beautiful and thoughtful things. Now, with that said, the books and the art in here, the art comes largely from local artists. But there's a story behind every single thing that you see, and I'm happy to tell you that story after Larry gets done talking, ask me about anything. I want to thank all of those artists because a tremendous number of people have spent a tremendous number of hours in this house making it the sort of work of art that it is. Gay and I are deeply, deeply appreciative of the way that they've sort of put themselves into all of this. Beyond that, there are the people who have left their books to us, the vast majority of whom are no longer with us. Doug Anderson's books are here, and John's books, some of them are here, not a bunch more of them are going to be here beginning tomorrow. And of course, my books are here, but my former teacher, Charles Sherover, is partly responsible for starting this. He left me thousands and thousands of books, many of which are at the Dewey Center, at least for the moment. Left me thousands and thousands of books which had to be sorted, and one had to decide what to do with them. And that's where this process began in about 2003, really. Creighton Peden, being the most recent donor, he passed away a few months ago, and his family left his books and his papers here. He was a very fine American intellectual historian who wrote 9 books during his retirement that needed to be written that no one else was going to be able to write or willing to write. And so Creighton Peden's stuff is in here. His portrait is in the Institute room there, and his family kindly left that portrait to us as well. So many other people in between. John Howie's books are here. Remember John. Howard Greatest's books are here. Many Carl Hausman's books are here because Doug Anderson left them to us. Carl Hausman is still with us down in Louisville, but he's divested himself of his books and they're here. And the list of folks who have been willing to invest themselves in this project for the ongoing future is a longer list than I'm giving, but those are some of the major donations that have been made. And so, with that list of thank yous in place, the main person I need to thank is the person I now introduce, which is John Shook, who deserves all of the blame and some of the credit for the idea for this institute. And he is now, he's the president of the institute, and he's now going to tell you about what the idea is here. So without further delay, I'll turn it over to John Shook.
Thank you, everybody, for coming out tonight. I am the president of this new institute because I drew the short straw, so I had to be president. I want to get a picture of you all. We're documenting this, and I am going to stand back and look cheerful and interested as if I just said something completely hilarious. There you go. Thank you. Well, stunned silence will do as well. Okay. This is the grand opening of the American Institute for Philosophical and Cultural Thought, and it germinated in a conversation I was having with Randy at one of my annual pilgrimages here. I've never taught in Illinois. I was sent here by my mentor, and I'm going to indulge in just a brief intellectual genealogy for the meaning of this to me before I go into more formal remarks to explain what the heck is going on. The year was 1992, and I had just told my most favorite professor at the University of Buffalo, Peter H. Hare, who's now no longer with us, but he was the longtime editor of the Transactions of the Charles S. Peirce Society and leading light among many of keeping American philosophy alive and well. And I told him I was going to do my dissertation on John Dewey, and he gave me that benevolent smile of his, and his very next words were, "Well then, you're off to Carbondale." And I said, "What's a Carbondale?" And he explained that there was this place called Southern Illinois University in Carbondale, and I would have to go there, and I would have to pay my due respects to Larry Hickman, who's our honored speaker tonight. So I dutifully packed into a car all of my notes, some legal pads, and my then fiance, and we drove across the country and arrived in Carbondale, and I spent 3 days poring over letters and a very crucial research for an important phase of my dissertation. And so this place has been a beloved part of my academic heart ever since. So thank you, Peter. The American Institute for Philosophical and Cultural Thought aims to foster the study of philosophical and cultural thought in America. We collect and archive literary and educational resources, we provide access to these resources to scholarly researchers, and we disseminate education about American philosophical and cultural thought. That's at least the plan, right? This is official bannerhead stuff. We do have an archival library. That's in place. We're at about, with my books now arriving, 35,000 printed volumes. And that's not bad for a small college library. We're going to be able to host workshops, seminars, music, and cultural events, of course, here as well. The space is available for receptions. The community would be welcome to use it. And we can also host visiting scholars for shorter, longer durations. In fact, where's Thurman?
Right here.
Where's
right
Thurman?
Here.
Say hello to Thurman. He's our first scholar in residence.
Hello.
And he's working on a dissertation. We're also going to take advantage of new technologies. It's not just about the physical space. We're going to be looking for ways to make things accessible online as much as possible, because we want this to be a global enterprise as much as a local enterprise. Randy mentioned the three directors, myself and Randy and Larry Hickman. Just a little bit about us, so you know why at least on paper we appear to be qualified for undertaking this sort of enterprise. I'm a philosophy professor, been at it about 25 years. I currently live in the D.C. region. I'm teaching full-time at Bowie State University in Maryland. I've published extensively across the history of American philosophy and American intellectual history. I'm the editor of The Dictionary of Modern American Philosophers, The Dictionary of Early American Philosophers, Historical Essays in 20th Century American Philosophy, and the Bloomsbury Encyclopedia of Philosophers in America. So you kind of know what I've been up to. Dr. Randall Oxier is a professor of philosophy here at Southern Illinois University. He was the editor of the Library of Living Philosophers for many years. He edited the journal The Personalist Forum also for many years until we transformed it into The Pluralist, which is now published by the Society for the Advancement of American Philosophy, and we continued to edit that journal for a few additional years after that. He's the author of Time, Will, and Purpose, Living Ideas from the Philosophy of Josiah Royce, and he's also recently co-authored The Quantum of Explanation, Whitehead's Radical Empiricism, soon to be out, Randy?
Is that out in January?
In January, so that is.
Huh.
And Randy and I just reinvigorated the book series for American philosophy with the State University of New York Press, so we will have access to a publishing outlet as well. Finally, a word about Dr. Larry A. Hickman. He's Emeritus Director of the Center for Dewey Studies and also Emeritus Professor of Philosophy, Southern Illinois University. During the 1990s and 2000s, he edited the four vast sprawling volumes of the correspondence of John Dewey, which were published in an electronic edition, and it is magnificent. He's the author of many books. I can only list a few, including John Dewey's Pragmatic Technology, Philosophical Tools for Technological Culture, Pragmatism and Postmodernism, and a co-edited book called Living is Learning, John Dewey in the 21st Century. So now you know a little bit about us and our dedication, ample dedication to American philosophy. But we also should understand why this institute needs to be here now. This institute is going to carry on some of the functions of the Center for Dewey Studies, which, regrettably, as many as you know, is in imminent danger of closing. Larry Hickman would be a source of information about the history and current status of those matters, which I'm going to pass over here. The Center for Dewey Studies has been the preeminent place for advanced study of American pragmatism. Hundreds of scholars over the decades have traveled from their home countries to come here to Little Carbondale to do research on American thought, American intellectual history, perhaps pragmatism, past or current. It is really an impressive way that those scholars have been able to carry back that knowledge back to their home countries and in turn inspire additional interest in dozens and dozens and dozens of countries around the world, including a few new Dewey centers, of which now number
14,
so well over a dozen already, and no doubt more in Genesis. We want Southern Illinois to continue to be able to maintain that level of hospitality, to sustain and grow that momentum for further generations of scholars interested in what's going on in America. And of course, the heart of an institute is its library, and our heart is strong. The collection of books and papers in this house have arrived from a number of living supporters. Randy mentioned a few. I have my own list with a few additional names. If there's repetition, that's okay, because they deserve it. We should mention especially some living donors, Richard T. Hull, Doug Anderson, of course, Carl Hausman, and members of the board, Randy and I principally, along with generous collections from the estates of over a dozen distinguished professors, including Charles Sherover, John Howie has been mentioned, Warren Steinkraus, Stan Thayer, Joanne Boydston, Abraham Adel, Howard Radis has been mentioned, and Creighton Peden, and many more, too many to be named. There are many first editions, rare books here, as well as important papers and correspondence. We are grateful for that tremendous confidence that these scholars have placed in us as a depository for their works. One last comment. We believe that this institute has been founded at a crucial time for humanities in general in America. The growing neglect for humanistic learning and humanities at institutions of higher learning, and even the widespread tendency of our culture today to ignore or dismiss humanistic learning is, I guess, an occasion for pessimism, but we aren't by nature pessimists. In defiance of such pessimism, we've decided to create an independent home for humanistic thinking. We are devoted to conserving and conveying that treasure of inherited values and achievements into the future. Tonight's impressive show of support in this endeavor is wonderful, and we hope for continued community support. It's now time for the inaugural lecture for the American Institute in Philosophical and Cultural Thought. Help me welcome Dr. Larry A. Hickman, who will give us a talk on Humanism, the Humanities, and Technoscience.
Well, thank you very much. I've got a little allergy, which means some coughing, so I hope you'll bear with me. The title, as you just heard in my talk, is Humanism, Humanities, and Technoscience. Before I get into it, however, I want to say what a pleasure it is to be here for this inaugural event of the American Institute for Philosophical and Cultural Thought. This is an extremely gutsy project, but it's not surprising that it would be initiated by these two guys, because they've got a great vision for how things work and how they should be. And I know that given the difficulties that the Dewey Center is facing at this point, that this may be the place to come to have the resources necessary for research in American philosophy and American culture. This evening, I want to talk about how the humanities have dealt with the problems of technology. And also, I want to talk about the humanist approach to questions that, shall we say, bedevil our culture. And I want to suggest the ways in which these ideas are related. Now, one of the most important questions we face as a culture concerns whether and to what extent ethical and moral systems can keep pace with the rapid growth of the technosciences. This is a question that occupied John Dewey from the 1880s until his death in 1952. Given the fact that Dewey's star still shines bright in the humanist firmament, it's highly appropriate that we turn to his work for some suggestions, which I will do in a couple of minutes. First, however, I want to put some cards on the table. By using the term technoscience, I mean to follow Dewey in the following claims. First, that prior to the 17th century, what human beings had for the most part was not science, but proto-science. Aristotle's wonderful taxonomic study of shellfish, for example, was empirical, not experimental, since it lacked a systematic integration of instrumentation at the level of invention, use, and further development. On the side of proto-scientific engineering, one finds during the Roman era, for instance, the construction of the Pantheon, the largest dome of its time. Studies have shown, however, that the design for the structure developed over time by means of specific increments, incremental changes in practices. There was nothing systematic about this. And there was no comprehensive commitment to experimentation in the sense that we know it today. And it is in this sense, the role of instruments in the sciences, that there's no pure science. I've listened to colleagues, especially when I was at Texas A&M for 20 years, working in the sciences, and protest that they do pure science, while even as we spoke, they had a research team working with instrumentation that cost millions of dollars. Second, and by way of obviating a frequent objection to this claim, I also follow Dewey in holding the view that the differences between tools that are concrete and those that are abstract is functional, not ontological. And there's a long history of making this distinction. In fact, it even works its way into folk psychology and popular culture, that somehow ideas are on one side and material logics are on another. This is precisely one of those core issues that Dewey took up and dealt with in a very important way. From the standpoint of a genetic analysis, concrete and abstract tools are developed and improved in much the same way. This is the point that Dewey made as early as 1916. How are the tools and machines of farming developed and improved? They emerge not by farming, but from farming. How are the tools of logic and ethics developed and improved? They emerge not by formal practices and exercises in logic and ethics, but from inquiry into formal practices in those fields. It is in this sense that a mathematician is no less involved in technical inquiry than is a bench scientist. In both cases, there are raw materials, there are intermediate stock parts, there are tools, there are ends in view, and end products. I would say also this puts the novelist in the same category. Writing a novel is also a kind of technology. When technology is involved, there's also systematic inquiry into the nature and function of the respective tools and techniques with a view to their further development. And third, despite the confusion produced by the English language, in this case, we cannot put technology in a box. Even Scientific American got this wrong when they published a report entitled 10 Technologies That Turned Our Heads, 2003 CES in Pictures. European languages such as German and Spanish get it right. There are tools, techniques, or techne, and then there's the logos, or the rationality, or inquiry into techne. Inquiry into tools and techniques. In short, there are tools and techniques, and there is technology. Technology is the logos, the rationality, inquiry into those tools and techniques. One of the implications of this view is that technology is a form of inquiry, not just a collection of objects. It is a set of methods for increasing our knowledge about how things work and how we can do things better. The methods of the technosciences on this view constitute a subset of this larger domain of inquiry, as do the methods of the social sciences, the sciences, jurisprudence, historiography, and engineering, and ethics. It's a matter of confusion to some and a matter completely unknown to others that Dewey more or less identified this overarching sense of technology with logic or the theory of inquiry. Fourth, much of the history of philosophical discussions about technology has looked in the wrong direction. What some have called the classical period of the philosophy of technology commonly thought to have begun with Heidegger, Heidegger's 1927 book, Being in Time, Sight with Sight. Continuing well into the 60s, that view was characterized by pessimism, preoccupation with issues such as alienation, loss of authenticity, and technological determinism. Key players in this period included Karl Jaspers and Martin Heidegger. Although the early Heidegger of the 1920s advanced an existentialist phenomenological reading of tools and techniques from which we can still learn a great deal, his well-known turn after World War II led him to the view that human beings are imprisoned in a technological world which it is unable to master. Moreover, his disastrous flirtation with National Socialism led him to view democracy as an inadequate response to our technological milieu. In his now famous Der Spiegel interview, he suggested that, quote, only a God can save us. I was just thinking about that guy who said, only I can save us. Said, only a God can save us from what he took to be an increasingly deteriorating situation of a civilized people, his fellow Germans, sandwiched between barbaric communism of the East and the dreadful instrumentalist ends justify means capitalism of the West. Then there were the first generation Frankfurt School critical theorists, Max Horkheimer and Theodore Adorno. They too thought that technology was the problem. That is, instrumental rationality was muscling out what was distinctively human. Their Frankfurt School's successor, Jürgen Habermas, although known in some circles as the German Dewey, for his work on human rights and similar issues, which have been very important, he had very little to say about technology after his book Knowledge and the Human Interest, published in German in 1968 and in English in 1971. Habermas would more or less identify the technosciences as simply data gatherers. To this, he opposed the value concerns of communicative and emancipatory action that could, in his view, both provide a buffer for human life world against the encroachments of technology and even push back some of its advances. It doesn't take much imagination here to see one of the classical fact value splits that has haunted the history of Western philosophy. Pushback against these dark scenarios began in the 1970s. In his 1977 work, Autonomous Technology, Langdon Winner, who's still, I think, active professor at Rensselaer Polytechnic, sought to drill down to past the treatments of technology as a big autonomous thing. And he provided case studies to support his argument that artifacts have politics. So he's trying to overcome that fact-value distinction. During the 80s and 90s, thanks to the work of Don Eide and others, including a younger generation of philosophers working in the field of environmental ethics, the ethics of food biotechnology, medical ethics, and so on, philosophical critiques of technology took an empirical turn. One of the centers of gravity of this new constellation was the Netherlands, where philosophers were actually hired by government. Imagine that. Philosophers hired by government agencies to analyze ways in which tools and techniques could support a more ecologically and socially friendly way of life. Gone, or at least quarantined, were grand overarching transcendental speculations about the nature of technology, which sometimes bordered on reification of a big T technology, and at other times completely capitulated to that concept. So emphasis changed from attempting to understand how big T technology related to capital B being, to how material tools and artifacts actually function in the life worlds of actual human beings. Ide's post-phenomenological approach provided case studies that undercut instrumentalism, that is the idea that tools are value-free and its corollary that ends justify means. Ide and his colleagues provided a painstaking analysis of the ways that tools and techniques are multivalent. This is a very important idea in this context, so let me repeat it. It is the idea that tools and techniques are not value neutral, but that they teem with values. They are multivalent. As important as this empirical turn was, however, there were some early critics who viewed its descriptivist emphasis as overly narrow, because it tended to leave ethical concerns outside of the scope of inquiry, or at least as an add-on after the real work had been accomplished. I should also mention the work of Bruno Latour, who's argued that individual agent theories should be replaced with actor network theories. This was an important move because it took a systems or contextual approach to ethics that looks a lot like Dewey's pragmatism, and in fact, Andrew Wellfenberg, who's a good friend of Latour's, told me that Latour has spent a lot of time reading Dewey. That could be why it looks a lot like Dewey. Latour thus undercut faulty assumptions about atomic ethical agents, the moral equivalent of the rational agents of the neoliberal economic theory. On this view, there's no more a homo ethicus in that sense than there is a homo economicus. There are instead relational networks of humans, tools, techniques, and other artifacts that require evaluation in much more sophisticated ways than are possible on the individual agent account. More of this in a moment. Now, more recently, Dutch philosopher of technology Peter Paul Verbeek, drawing on the work of Michel Foucault, has called for an ethical turn past the empirical turn. And this would, he called upon philosophers of technology to find ways of, quote, making visible the close intertwining of technology and humanity. This may not be the best way of putting the humanist project with respect to tools, techniques, and technology, but at least suggest there are some useful tools out there for thinking about that project. For one thing, Verbeek thought it helpful to divide the ethical inquiry that goes into construction of our tools and techniques into three stages: development, implementation, and use. Each of these stages involves its own particular ethical moral challenge and strategy, although there's usually some sort of overlap. For another thing, these three types of decision-making might be brought to bear on ethical-moral dimensions of what are generally recognized as four non-exhaustive types of tools and techniques. First, there are force technologies, such as speed bumps and traffic circles. There is law enforcement maneuver, just as one can imagine countless meetings, city councils, which host discussions concerning the height and location of speed bumps. I live in a community which has a homeowners association, and one of the main topics of conversation at the meetings has to do with the height and location of speed bumps. A lot of values there, a lot of interests. A recent, and some might say hilarious, example of debate over force technology at the implementation stage pitted a Minnesota congresswoman who was running for president recently against legislative efforts to discontinue inefficient incandescent light bulbs on the ground that such action would stifle, quote, liberty by forcing people to use more environmentally friendly ones. You may have caught her act. Second, there are seductive technologies, such as market design, where product placement seduces buyers towards certain brands by shelf placement, color, or even ambient audio video. Given the seduction strategy, it's hardly accidental that tabloids featuring overweight female celebrities in bikinis always seem to be placed next to waiting lines in grocery checkout counters. Forgot your chewing gum, your breath mints, or Snicker bars? How about your National Enquirer? You're ripe for seduction. In general, seductive technologies tend to offer a degree of flexibility in the end user in the sense that a better educated shopper is the greater probability that he or she can resist this seduction. But this can also go the other way. Even the best educated nerd will probably still fall prey to the seductive charms of the latest smartphone. Third, there are persuasive technologies that express their values by seeking to persuade their users to inquire more deeply into the various aspects of their behavior and take appropriate action. One of my favorites is Baby Think It Over, for example. It's a computerized infant simulator. It's a lifelike, life-size baby doll with realistic computerized responses that allows teens to experience some of the demands of infant care. This product is promoted by Horizon Solutions, a branch of Horizons International, which in its turn a project of the Yale Department of Biology. Fourth, I should mention ambient technologies, such as automatic doors, smart thermostats, and increasingly browsers such as Google, express their values in the backgrounds and sometimes the foregrounds of our lives. These categories are not exclusive, by the way. Google should also probably be listed under the seductive technology heading. These ambient technologies are the focus of much current concern, for instance, as we know regarding the debate about fake news. For one thing, there's the fear in some quarters that our technical environment may become so transparent that we will become morally disengaged. That is, that our tools and techniques might take over the job of moral decision-making for us, leaving human beings either morally flabby or out of the loop entirely. And, of course, there's a lot of ethical debate going on about what? Self-driving cars. The same criticism has been leveled against force technology. One of the more persistent critics of low-level ambient technology has been Albert Borgman, who has gone, a student of Heidegger's, by the way, who has gone so far as to oppose central air conditioning in favor of wood-burning stoves. His neo-Heideggerian point seems to be that ambient tools and techniques deracinate us from our earthly abode in ways that diminish our humanity. I should probably add that he does not seem overly concerned with the local air pollution that such heaters cause. Borgman's concern with wood-burning stoves aside, it is a large-scale ambient technologies that are at the same time the most interesting and the most problematic from the standpoint of valuation. Large-scale ambient technologies such as the internet are so rich in values, explicit and implicit, designed and accidental, it's probably not possible to estimate the number of people whose careers involve evaluation of those values. One of the most public, in the sense of publicly discussed, values of internet browsers is, of course, the issue of privacy. Now, the stated mission of the Center for Democracy and Technology, for example, includes enhancing freedom of expression, protecting privacy, and limiting government surveillance. And I also mentioned the Electronic Frontier Foundation, Privacy International, and Electronic Privacy Information Center. I find time pursuing these websites and their reports really pays off. In one report, for instance, Privacy International reports that, quote, Saudi women are being electronically tracked by their male guardians, who are automatically sent text messages when their female dependents, unquote, attempt to cross a border. For women seeking to escape abusive relationships or simply the severe generalized depression of women that operates throughout Saudi Arabia, the measure could be the nail in their coffins. As potentially dangerous as some of the design and implementation values of the internet may be, to say nothing of some of its use values, I nevertheless suggest that this situation hardly provides adequate reason to return to the good old autonomy of technology debates of yesteryear, the point of going back to the Heideggerian classical philosophy of technology. See, although there are some efforts on the part of some young scholars to rehabilitate the old way of doing things, I suppose there are always efforts to rehabilitate old ideas. The Croatian philosopher Slavoj Žižek, I believe he's Croatian, Slovenian, has been trying to rehabilitate Stalin, for instance. It's hard to imagine that, but that's what he does. As potentially dangerous as some of the design and implementation, then, we don't really want to go back to that. Now, what can we say about possible humanist evaluations and contributions of our network of rapidly changing tools, techniques, and technology? Now, so far, I've indicated where philosophers have been with respect to our understanding of technology, as well as where we seem to be headed. In other words, this is a report from the humanities, an incomplete report, but at least one that gives us a sense of direction. And I've also suggested that some tools are available for thinking about such matters. When we turn to consider possible courses of actions by humanists, in the sense of secular humanists, in the sense of a wider sense of humanists, however, the issues tend to get somewhat murky. I've mentioned just four of the many foundations that are dedicated to evaluation of the ethical dimensions of emerging technologies, for instance. And here, again, I'm not talking about the products, I'm talking about the inquiry that goes into the products. Given the enormous number of players and the complexity of the issues involved, what is the best course of action for humanists? One possible answer has to do with the cultivation of alliances. First, humanists need to seek alliances with philosophers and others who reject the humanist's broad sense, need to seek alliance with philosophers and others who reject instrumentalist conceptions of technology. That is, who reject the view that tools and techniques are ethically and morally neutral, and it is therefore their use that determines their value. Humanists need to seek alliances with philosophers and others who reject individual agent-centered ethics in favor of system or context-based ethics, such as Bernard Latour's actor-network theory, which I mentioned earlier in the presentation. Now, a classical example of this instrumentalist individual agent type of ethical argument has been advanced by the National Rifle Association. Guns don't kill people, people kill people. We've heard this mantra for years. But as philosopher Evan Selinger has pointed out, there's a significant problem with this type of argument. According to the NRA, people are the kinds of beings we can immorally evaluate. We could call someone good or someone bad, but we only call an instrument bad in the metaphorical sense, or say that it's working or it's not working. But if we take off the instrumentalist individual agent blinders, it makes more sense to think about the interaction between humans and guns in a system-based actor network way rather than an individual agent instrumentalist way. A person holding a gun, Selinger points out, becomes a part of a human gun system. And we might add, that system becomes a part of a larger actor network system that includes poverty levels, availability of mental health care, licensing and training of firearms, and so on and so on and so on. At each level of the system, and in each part of it, there are tools and artifacts that express values that result from design, implementation, and use. Some of them, like hunting rifles, mental health facilities, and food banks, are concrete. Others, such as the Second Amendment, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, and school lunch menus, are conceptual. But all of these things are constructive technical artifacts, and none of them are value-free. This was one of John Dewey's great insights more than a century ago. When we talk about the values, implicit as well as explicit, that are built into our tools, techniques, and artifacts, and that evolve as they are used, we begin to see that the distinction between concrete tools and conceptual tools is only functional. As I've already indicated in Dewey's genetic analysis, we construct our ethical norms over time as tools for living together and as a part of our environment in the same sense in which the norms of farming are constructed over time as tools for improving agricultural production. Or, I might add, as the rules for vehicular traffic are constructed over time. There is nothing transcendental about rules for traffic, vehicular traffic. They have developed over time, and in some cases they are cultural bound, but they are improving and moving toward a kind of convergence in terms of the way that vehicular traffic is monitored and restricted. You don't need foundational stuff for that. You don't need a foundation on this analogy. You don't need a foundation for ethics. What you need is a genealogy and a way of thinking about the way things have developed and how to do things better. On this genetic analysis, then, a metaphor is as much a constructed object as a hammer, and both carry with them certain values that have been built into them and that are subject to continuing evaluation. To adhere blindly to the NRA's instrumentalist argument, therefore, amounts to an ethical failure. It's to ignore the stubborn fact that guns have certain values built into them at the stages of design and implementation. At the stages of design and implementation, certain choices have been made about purposes, including the degree of lethality, and at the level of use, the way that guns are able to be modified or carried or stored involves ethical issues as well. Now, it's interesting to note that after a period of silence following the Newtown, Connecticut tragedy, the leadership of the NRA suddenly pivoted away from their longstanding position that guns don't kill people, people kill people. I find it interesting that their new mantra continues an ever so tiny step, constitutes an ever so tiny step toward an actor network account. Their new mantra is, the only thing that stops a bad guy with a gun is a good guy with a gun. And even though this claim is manifestly false, it is nevertheless interesting because the shift in the thinking it betrays. Instead of two things, a value-neutral gun and a human that we can evaluate, we now have two human gun systems, both of which we can evaluate. And once we open the door, that door, then the whole actor network landscape is available to us. What makes the bad guy gun network bad? What makes the good guy gun network good? What is their place in even wider networks of persons, objects, and institutions? What values are expressed at each of these different levels? Now, if it makes sense for humanists to ally themselves with philosophers and others who want to move beyond instrumentalist and individual agent accounts evaluation, then I believe it also makes sense for humanists to ally themselves with those who hold a weak form of anthropocentrism. Strong anthropocentrism, as I quote the term, is a view that pits human life against an external environment and sanctions domination of nature. It is the view that since nature and its transcript science are value neutral, then just any means may be used to satisfy human desires or felt preferences. As opposed to strong anthropocentrism, a weak form of anthropocentrism holds that both human life and its wider context, non-human nature, are unintelligible absent the recognition that it is only with the advent of reflective consciousness that nature comes to have deliberate preferences. It is only with the advent of reflective consciousness that nature comes to have a mind of its own. Dewey, I follow Dewey in this regard in distinguishing between felt values and considered values. Felt values are just that. They are immediate and just what they are. Considered values are those that have been evaluated. The difference is roughly analogous to the difference between something that has been eaten and something that is edible. The one immediately enjoyed or perhaps regretted, the other having proven of gustatory and gastronomic value. Weak anthropocentrism, then, has the advantage of holding that the source of value lies within human evaluation, whereas the location of value lies within our natural environment. In other words, it is human beings who construct durable value by means of evaluation. What weak anthropocentrism denies, of course, is that forces external to nature intervene with evaluation and that the source of value resides in non-human nature and that human beings are only the location of value. In other words, the human solution to this problem is to say that sources of value are neither in the heavens nor in the earth. They are, in fact, in human judgment. Third, and also very briefly, I'd suggest that non-religious humanists serve their cause well if they seek allies among religious humanists. Advocates of the so-called new atheism may have their place in academic debates, staking out and occupying ideological turf on the left, but in areas where policy is formulated for education, science, health, to name a few, a more centrist approach is likely to prove more productive. I find it helpful to think of religious organizations in pragmatic terms rather than in terms of ontological commitments. What are their goals and ends in view? What sorts of tools do they use to get there? What positive and negative effects do they have within the public sphere? The plain fact is that religious institutions are deeply informed by the tools and techniques they've chosen and have evolved within their practices over time. It is in no way misleading to speak of religious technologies in this sense. And even a casual look reveals that religious technologies are changing very rapidly. Now, to a great extent, and I would suggest increasingly so, religions are technologies of community. Why did the citizens of Newtown, Connecticut turn to their religious institutions in the time of their tragedy? Most likely because these institutions had tools and techniques of community at the ready. They had emotionally significant rituals, tools and techniques, if you will, that had been designed with certain values in mind and in the use of which the public had been trained. This should be no problem for a committed naturalist or as opposed to a supernaturalist. However, since, as Dewey reminded us, religious experience is a natural phenomenon, the lesson for these secular humanists, I believe, is that the tools of community are being developed and deployed among religious humanists, that cooperation with religious humanists is crucial in the areas of social and political life, and perhaps above all, that social networking is now taking place, the place of traditional religious institutional practice. And here I would include Unitarians, some brands of Buddhism, some strands of Judaism, social gospel Christians, among others. Cooperation with religious humanists by secular humanists is crucial in the areas of social and political life. Cooperation with religious humanists by secular humanists is crucial in the areas that are open to networking. Now, speaking of education, we should not forget that the people of Newtown also went to the schools as well as the churches, and the schools also utilized and developed tools of community. Now, during the last few minutes, I've offered some suggestions regarding what we mean when we talk about technology, and I've suggested that it behooves us to develop robust and flexible taxonomies of types of tools and techniques to attempt to identify potential sources of technical failure by expanding the role of education and expertise in public science and technology policy, and to change the way we talk about evaluation, from value-neutral tools to multivalence and engaged evaluation, and from individual actor networks to individual actor theories to actor network theories. I've also suggested that in some ways the humanists can embrace and cultivate allies in the cause of reforming our technological milieu along the lines envisioned by John Dewey during his lengthy career. I might add, given the current situation in D.C., I think we're in for a rough ride given the appointment of the climate change denier to, or the prospective appointment, the nomination of a climate change denier to the head of the EPA. This strikes me as an indication of the rough ride we're in for as people who think critically about such matters and who take evidence and reasoned arguments seriously. Thank you very much.